first full week of the spring season. It has been a beautiful week, and we're going to conclude this morning our spring series, which has been focusing on worship. We started a few weeks ago discussing first why God is worthy of worship. The title of the series is, O Worship the King. God is our King. Well, why do we? Why is He worthy of our worship? We discussed that in the beginning. And 2 weeks ago, we looked at worship from God's perspective. That is to say, why does God command worship? Why does He look at us, His creation, and say, I expect you to worship me? And so we talked a little bit about the mindset and character of God with respect to that. And then last week, we looked at it from our perspective. What is our responsibility and our obligations when it comes to worship, kind of in a general sense? Let's end the series this morning with a simple, fundamental look at the things that we do as acts of worship. So similar in content, but to last week in terms of the theme, the idea. We're talking about our responsibilities, but we're going to get more specific this morning. What are the things that we do and why, and how should we do those things in worship? Unless I'm missing something, I think you could break down all the things that we do in worship into five categories. We pray together in worship. We sing together in worship. We give an offering as a collective body together. We commune as a family with Christ together, and we study God's Word together. So let me give you just two thoughts briefly, and then we'll turn over to Ryan and to the men who are going to lead us in prayer and communion. But just two thoughts about worship before. Usually we end, but I want to begin with the study this morning. So two things to consider. First of all, why are those five things the things that we do in worship? And then after that, what does God expect of us on an individual basis and on a congregational one when we do those things? So first of all, why are those things, the things that we know very well, that we do every week, we study, we sing, we pray, we take the Lord's Supper, we offer, give an offering. Why are those the things that we consider acts of worship? First of all, prayer is mentioned as an act of worship in your Bible, as all of these are. This one is mentioned in Acts 2:42. But what makes prayer an act of worship? You have Bible verse 4, but why is prayer an act of worship? Well, think about the things that we do when we pray. When you pray, whether as an individual or as a congregation, when you pray, you are falling down at the feet of God in a metaphorical sense, but also quite actually, quite genuinely, you are falling before God and bringing Him your petitions, bringing Him your needs, bringing Him your desires, and bringing Him your thanks. That expresses, therefore, this idea that you recognize God is your provider. He is the one that you look to give you what you need in life. And also, when you give Him thanks, it is your way of expressing gratitude for God, for what He has given you, and trust in what He will give you based on His will in the future. Prayer, therefore, is an expression of gratitude and devotion, which are two essential elements in worship. I think everyone would agree. To worship someone is to express devotion to them. To worship someone is to express gratitude to them. Now, not all devotion is worship. Not all gratitude is worship. I'm devoted to my wife. I'm grateful for my elders, but I don't worship my elders. I don't worship my wife. Not all devotion is worship, but I worship Christ, and in worshiping Christ, I'm expected to offer Him devotion. I'm expected to be grateful to Him, and I do so when I pray to Him. I express that there is none higher, there is none greater, there is no more bountiful hand than His that I would want to turn to. I don't pray to any other God or any other person. I pray to Him. That expression of that describes a concept of worship. Singing, likewise, is an act of worship. It's an act of worship to God. Colossians 3:16 teaches us. But why is singing worship? I think it is because when we sing, we are vocally expressing in a very special kind of way our devotion to God. It's another way. Singing is just another way of saying praise be to God. Four little words. You can say those words, and if you say them from the heart, then that's a wonderful thing. That is a worshipful expression. Praise be to God. But when you sing, you take those four words and you elongate it into four beautiful verses in a song with melody and with harmony and with beauty in a way that simply cannot be expressed with just four words. And it doesn't matter how pretty you sound or how terrible you sound. We all sound different. And some of us sound great and some of us do not sound great. It doesn't matter the quality. It matters the heart that is in the worship. And that's true of all of these. Some people can make beautiful, eloquent prayers. Some people, they can't even... They couldn't even tell you what their address is in a public forum without stuttering and stumbling. It's just, everybody's different. But if you express what you're expressing from the heart, and you're doing it in the way God wants you to do it, which half of that is from the heart, then it doesn't matter how pretty it sounds to my ears, because ultimately, it goes to his ears. But think about singing and how singing is used as an act of worship. I mean, what is worship? In all of these, the one key component is an offering of some kind. I'm giving God my petitions and not some other God. I'm giving God my ears to listen to his word. I'm giving God my, in this case, my voice. I am taking my voice that he created for me, my larynx, my esophagus, my lungs. I'm taking everything that I have inside me, and I am manipulating it. I am changing it. I am contorting it to make it sound like something different. My singing voice is not my speaking voice. That's true of every human being on the planet. Your speaking and singing voice. In fact, the manipulation comes from different parts of your very brain, which is why some people who are having a stroke are told if you sing to them, you can help the effects of it in a way you can't just speaking to them. It's weird the way your brain can process sound of a melodic kind and sound from a simple, straight, rote, audible kind. Singing is different by your very creative makeup. God designed it so. And so you take that voice that God gave you and you manipulate it to make a different kind of sound and to form something that you can give as an offering to him. This is an offering when you sing, except it's an offering you don't have to buy. It's an offering you don't have to hunt for, as in the olden days. It's right there in your lungs and in your larynx. You give your voice to God. It's the most heavenly form of worship. The angels in heaven, they don't pray to God the way we do, because God doesn't need to grant them petitions they may have. They are just pure servants in a literal, direct sense. But they do, when they worship God, sing to God. Isaiah talks about that in Isaiah chapter 6. Now look at another one, third out of five. Why is giving a financial offering? Why is putting a check in the plate or putting some cold, hard cash or whatever it is, some kind of a financial offering, why is that an act of worship? Honestly, it is probably the most obvious on the surface action of worship that we do, and yet it's one of the more neglected parts, just generally speaking, especially when it comes to doing it right. And doing it right is not, again, with everything else, it's not about the quantity or the amount in this case, but it's about the heart, Paul says in 2 Corinthians 9:7. But regardless, putting money in a silver plate as we have here, some people have a wicker basket or a beautiful ornate gold thing, or it's just a hat passed around back in 100 years ago, whatever it is actually an act of worship, because worship involves, by its very definition, sacrifice. In the Old Testament, you had this concept of, I killed this animal, I'm going to give it to God. That is my food. I killed it. I have to hunt for my food. And there's no Walmart where I can go. It's already been made. I have to go, and I looked for it. I sought for it. I stayed out all day and night, and I found this wonderful meal, and I hunted for it, and I killed it. And I'm going to give it to God. I'm not going to have it. God's going to have it. Does God have a stomach? Does God have those kinds of needs? No, but I'm going to give it to God because he demands a sacrifice. I have grown this great harvest. I've worked hard for months and months to develop this crop and to cultivate it and to nurture it and to make it grow this wonderful harvest. And I'm going to take it and collect it. I'm going to give God the literal cream of the crop. And I will eat the literal bottom of the barrel. I will give God the best. Does God have a stomach? Does God need that food? I will give it to God and I will eat the actual leftovers. Because God demands a sacrifice. Today there are no Levites that you go and you bring your animal to, that you go and you bring your harvest crop to. But in the Old Testament, when they did that sort of thing, it was a sacrifice. It was an act of worship because it was a sacrifice. That meat and that crop was their money. That was their source of income and their source of sustenance. And in sacrificing it, it was a genuine sacrifice, which God demanded then and still demands today. Financial offering is still an act of worship as it was then. It's you're not throwing a hunk of steak on the plate. You're giving something else in a more direct sense. This is still money out of my pocket. I'm giving it to God, who doesn't need it in a literal sense, but demands it in a worshipful sense. Why is taking communion an act of worship? You ever thought about that? We do that. If there's one thing that some brethren hold on to more than any other act of worship, I know some brethren, they will not sing a note. For whatever excuse they come up with, they will not even listen to the prayer. They'll keep their eyes open, they'll look around at everybody else. They will not pay attention to one word of the sermon, they won't do anything. I have seen congregations, I have seen a couple of old ladies, you don't need to know who they are, you wouldn't even know if I told you, who go every single Sunday, they never miss. They go in there, they sit down, they take communion, and they get up and leave. They don't stay for any of the singing afterward. They don't stay for the prayers after. They don't stay for the preaching. They just take communion and they leave. Because they think, I've punched my ticket. I've eaten my cracker. I'm drinking my Welch's. I'm done. And that's how they see it. I've just done the thing. that is not why communion is so special. Or rather, that is to say, communion is not special just by your doing it. Communion is special because of Him. I am just a participant in it. I don't get to punch a ticket and say, look what I've done. I've eaten, I've drank, and now look at what I've done. No. Communion is about my relationship with God on an individual and yet also as a collective basis, because we are eating this meal together. Why is communion an act of worship? Because eating a meal with someone is, in its purest sense, a form of solidarity, an expression of fellowship. And when we take communion, we are eating that meal not just with each other here in this room, but we are eating that meal with God Himself. Jesus says, when you take it, I am taking it with you. Matthew 26:29. He eats it with His Christians, spiritually speaking. If a non-Christian takes communion, we don't have what's called closed communion. We don't say you can't take it because you're not in our church. And there are religious groups that do that. They will forbid you to deny it. We don't do that. But we recognize, you have to recognize, biblically speaking, if a non-Christian takes it, whether it's a child or an adult or anything in between, to them it is just a cracker. It is just Welch's grape juice, that much. That's all it is. But it means more to me because I am a Christian. And I am told as a Christian, when I eat that cracker, it's not just a cracker. It is symbolic of the very body of Jesus Christ, which He broke. When He broke that bread to pass with His friends to eat around the dinner table, He's saying, I'm going to break my body in submission to God's will. When He offered that fruit of the vine to His friends at His dinner table, and He tells me, I'll drink it with you, it is a symbolic representation of His blood, which He shed, which He poured out. As we pour out in the individual cups, we can all take individually, but collectively, because we are all individual Christians, but collectively part of the church. And we recognize that we are saved by that broken body and by that blood. And so when we all take it, we are sharing in this fellowship with Christ and with no other God. We are saying to Him, it is our way of expressing that original commandment from the Old Testament, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt eat no other meals with any other gods. I don't take communion with any other god. I take communion with Christ. And that expression is in and of itself a form of worship and devotion singularly to Christ the King. Finally, why is this what we're doing right here? Why is this an act of worship? When you pray, you talk to God and no other God. When you hear a Bible sermon, you are listening to God and no other God. Not me, certainly, but this, the Word of God. Not just the Word of God that is just recited to you because you could read it at home, but the Word of God which is taken and formed and presented through a topic or through a theme or some way that you can gain some greater understanding of it. That's the responsibility I have and every other preacher, according to 2 Timothy 4:2. Not just read the Word, but preach the Word. Take the Word and present it to the audience so they can have a greater understanding of it. And when you do that, you are giving God, as all this worship is, it's an act of giving, an act of offering. You're offering God your ears. You're offering God your heart. Talk to me as I talk to you, you say to Him. Before we close, let's re-examine those five acts of worship from this perspective. What does God expect of us as a congregation when we worship? What does He expect of us when we pray to Him as a congregation? Three quick things. First of all, He expects me to listen. I'm not talking about when I whisper my own prayers before I go to bed or in the morning or anything in between. I'm talking about when we're together and someone is leading a prayer and I say, Ryan, would you lead us in an opening prayer, whoever he's going to pick in just a little bit. And that person stands up and says, let's pray. That is not the time for me to close my eyes and say my own prayer. I do that when I go home. I'm only going to be with my brethren when I'm with my brethren. And when I'm with my brethren, someone is going to be leading us in the prayer. When someone stands up, when Ryan stands up in a minute to lead us in a song, if he sings Blessed Assurance, I'm not going to just start singing Amazing Grace. I can't sing my own song. I got to lead the song he's leading me into. We're studying worship right now. You're following my lead. I'm leading the worship in this particular part. You can't go reading through your Bible and reading about grace or baptism or anything in between. Those are great studies, but we're talking about worship. You have to follow the lead of the leader. And so when someone is leading us in prayer, that's not the time for me to whisper my own prayers. It's not the time for me to think about what I'm going to do when I get home. It's not football season anymore. I think the tournament is still going on. To wonder who's going to win or who's going to lose in the NCAA tournament. No, it's my time to follow the lead of our collective talking and bringing petitions to God. So he expects me to listen. He expects me to agree. Unless somebody... Generally speaking, when a prayer is led, the petitions are right, and the praise is good, I need to express my solidarity with the one leading it. That's what the word amen actually means. Amen is not the end. The word's the end, at the end of a fairy tale. You know, you say the prayer, I say the end, that means the prayer is over. The word amen just means, so be it. It means, let it be done. It means, let's do it, whatever it is. We offer petitions, please give me, give me, give me. But hopefully somewhere in there is my desire to serve, my understanding that I need to work, I need to be a servant of the kingdom of Christ. And so when I say amen, either audibly or just internally, I'm expressing my agreement with the prayer who was leading me, the one leading the prayer. And I'm saying, okay, we're going to do, and now we're going to, we've said we're going to do, now we're going to do. We're going to put into action, which is the third thing. He expects me to listen, he expects me to agree, he expects me to do. I've said amen. Now I need to go out and do it. You can't just say, God, please give me, give me, give me, and then just expect you don't have to do anything. We're called to be servants. What does he expect when we sing hymns together? Three things. He expects me to listen. Part of singing involves teaching one another as we bring our praise to God. Colossians 3:16 says, it's not the time to talk. It's not the time to write your contribution check. It's not all things I've done. It is the time to be taught to. Time to listen. And you can be taught those songs. Someone says, well, I don't know this song, so I'm not going to sing it. Well, listen. The notes are there. You don't have to read music. You can see if a note goes up, your voice goes high. If a note goes low, your voice goes low. If you can follow, generally speaking, you have a song leader who's leading you through it. You see the words right there. You can eventually figure it out. You just need to try. You need to listen. And then that leads to meaning you need to have passion. It doesn't matter how out of tune you are. Give it your all. Sing with your heart. Singing with your heart does not just mean sing sincerely. It means sing with enthusiasm. Are you thankful you're a Christian? I swear some people, I have heard them sing, I think they'd rather go to hell than go to heaven, the way they sing with so little enthusiasm. Because they're singing about heaven, but they're like the Grinch. I mean, if you have enthusiasm, you need to show it. There's no passion there. You're just going through the motions. Someone says, well, I don't know the song, so I'm not going to sing it. Well, I didn't know how to change a diaper until Jack came along. He's not here, so otherwise he'd be blushing. But I love Jack enough, I learned, and I changed his diaper at least four times. Which was poopy. So if you have a passion for something, you will put in the work to do it. You don't need to tell God you love God. You show it in your actions. You don't need to tell God you don't love God. You show it in your actions. You don't want to sing? Well, what if God said, well, I don't feel like saving you? Obviously, if the tables are turned, you change your attitude. He expects me, last thing to do, he expects me to sing. Whether you sing good or bad or anything in between, he expects you to stop being a sourpuss, to remember your salvation, to remember your safe state in Jesus Christ, to lift up your voice and be thankful for all that you have. What does he expect me to do when I or we together give a financial offering? Three things. He expects me to plan. Mumbling through a song with no passion is the same as tossing a 20 in the plate with no forethought. They're both ritualistic and hollow, and God wants your heart. And if he has your heart, everything else will just cascade perfectly down from it. When it comes to giving, that means you have to think about it. It means you have to prepare for it. It means you have to plan on it. I make X amount of money, you say to yourself. I will give God this amount. I will leave the rest for myself, the cream of the crop, and I get the leftovers. Same concept as in the Old Testament. Why doesn't it happen? Because the second thing he expects me to trust. But if I give, we say, this much, I set that aside first, and I have to live off this, well, then how am I going to pay for this? How am I going to pay for that? How am I going to take care of this? And we start to worry, and we let worry become our God, and we give to our worries instead of giving to our God. If I give to God, we say, I need to pay for these important things. How will I do it? And some of these things, worldly speaking, are important. You have medical bills, you have taxes, you have food, you have shelter. Those things aren't free. But Jesus says, give, and it will be given to you. Give, and in other words, I will take care of you. Luke 6:38. Sometimes we give and we don't give like we should, and we make excuses and we say, what about these things? And those things are not important. Maybe you can cut down your cable bill. Maybe you don't need to eat out as lavishly. Again, I speak to myself. Either way, none of those things, all those things are worldly. None of those things are more important than the desire by God to have his children sacrificed to him, because that shows your devotion, your trust, your love for him. Last thing he expects me to do is sacrifice. Do you earn money? Do you earn it part-time, full-time, or in retirement? He expects you to give it back. It doesn't matter if you're 17 and you're working your first job. It doesn't matter if you're 37 and you're working full-time. It doesn't matter if you're 67 and you're ready to hang it up. Are you being given something by God? He expects you to give back to God. And everybody, I do it too, every single person, in history who has led the prayer always says, you've given us so much, we're going to give you just a small, tiny little amount. And I get the heart behind it is there's nothing we can give to compare to what he's given us. But it's almost like we're talking ourselves into giving a tiny little fraction of what he expects. Because we keep using those words like, we're going to give back just a tiny little, small, insignificant, tiny, ridiculously small. Well, how small are we going to make it, right? Sacrifice means sacrifice. It's not a sacrifice if you kill a deer and you give God a mouse. In the Old Testament, that wouldn't cut it. Sacrifice. What does he expect when we commune during the Lord's Supper? Two things. He expects us to remember him, that is. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, he broke it. He took a drink and he passed it around and he said, this is my body which was broken, this is my blood which is given. I eat it with you now, he said, and I'll eat it with you in the kingdom. When I eat the broken bread, I remember that he broke his body for me. When I drink the cup, I remember that he gave his blood for me. The Lord's Supper is not the time to write the check, as I said. It's not the time the people watch, but the people watch too. Lord's Supper is not the time to fret over how long it's taking. It's not the time to grab the guy passing me the plate and say, I need to ask you about an insurance quote later. That's a true story. What are you even doing, man? What are you even doing? It's time to think about Jesus. It's not time to talk business. He expects a second thing, to reflect on ourselves. I'm eating his broken body. I'm drinking his shed blood because my body chose not to submit to him. I chose to sin. His blood was shed so that mine would not have to be because I chose not to submit. So I need to reflect on the fact that it's my sin that put his body in that plate. It's my sin that put his blood in that cup. And so when I eat that body and I drink that blood, I'm reminded of my own imperfections, my own flaws, and my own sin. To remember and reflect. Finally, what does he expect of us when we listen to a discourse from his word? Three things. He expects us to respect. Respect the word. These aren't stories. These are not legends. These are not fables. These are not based on a true story, exaggerated tales. This is the pure, unadulterated, factual, true word of God. It is history, the history of the God created world, focused exclusively on the desire of God to save your souls. It discusses in 66 books the sinfulness of man and the great riches of God's grace. It discusses the terror of hell and the wonderful blessings of heaven itself. It is history, poetry, prophecy, gospel. It is the letters of encouragement, rebuke, knowledge, and help. It's wonderful. It's the best book you have on your shelf. And unfortunately, it's only on too many people's shelves. It's the greatest piece of work God ever made. And when it's preached to you, and when it's preached to me, as it will be tonight for Sunday night, he expects us to respect it. Second thing, he expects your respect. Respect the speaker. He may not be preaching a killer sermon, or maybe he is. He may be bombing. I've done both. He may be constantly, perpetually mediocre. No comment. He may be the most boring person you've ever had to stare at for 20 minutes, or, whew, unfortunately for some, much longer. But don't just stare at him. Have enough respect for the word to respect the one preaching the word. Somewhere in there is something you can use. Somewhere in there is a nugget that you can draw from and you can turn into gold. We have a 4 Sunday night series where every 4 Sunday night, one of the men speaks, and I get to sit. I don't think it'll happen tonight because my kids are all sick or getting there. But usually I have an elementary school kid on either side and a loud toddler on my lap. It's the only time I get to sit with my children when it comes to this part of the worship. So I totally get, at least once a month, the hardness, the difficulty of paying attention because there's all kinds of ambient sounds that can distract you. I understand it. But try to cut through that is all I'm saying. And hear what is being said. He expects your respect for the word. He expects your respect for the speaker, if not the man, then the role that he occupies. Finally, he expects your respect. Respect the Lord. These are his words, ultimately. It's his Bible. The Father who orchestrated it, the Christ who executed it, the Holy Spirit that inspired it. When you're dismissive of the sermon, you're not insulting the preacher. You're insulting the word. When you drive home, as some people do, you drive home and you're just dissing the preacher, you're dissing the song leader, you're dissing the guy who led the prayer, you're just attacking the leaders of the worship. You're not attacking the men. You may think you are. You may think you're just venting, but you're really attacking God. This is his worship. These are his children that he's put in these roles to lead it. There are good preachers and there are bad preachers. I mean, in a entertainment sense, which means very little. There are preachers that could hold your attention. There are preachers who couldn't buy 5 minutes of your time, let alone 20 or 30. But every preacher who teaches the truth, everyone who leads you in worship, prayer, song, Lord's Supper, whatever, they are leading you, and they deserve your respect. In fact, if this one expectation, respect, was applied across the board in this avenue of worship, in all avenues of worship, and in every aspect of your Christian life, if you just had respect, which is easier said than done, you'd be amazed how much happier you'd be, how more enriched you'd feel, and you would completely reject this notion of, I didn't get anything out of the worship, that thing that is said too often. I didn't get anything out of it. You're not supposed to get anything. You're supposed to give. It's an offering. What can I give to my Lord? I can give him my heart. I can give him my voice. I can give him my financial offering. I can give him my ears. I can give him my mind. What am I giving? And if I give right with the right heart, the rest will fall into place. We started our worship service. I know it's a little differently. We started with the sermon. We usually end with them. But I thought it made more sense to start here so that the rest of our worship, we can maybe apply some of these principles to our singing, to our prayer, to the Lord's Supper and invitation offering. If you want to become a Christian, though, we'll wait. We'll pause everything right now. We'll baptize you into Christ, and you can resume the worship with us as a child of God. And you can pray as a child of God. You can commune as a child of God. You can give an offering as a child of God. You can sing as a child of God. If you are a child of God already, you need to repent, and you need to make your life right. If you feel like your worship has not been true as it should be, if it's reflective of a bad Christian life you're living right now, then repent.